In the last video, we talked about what instructions are and how they do things. We say that in order to get automation, instructions and data need to be stored in a memory grid. So we need to turn on these memory units to get the content. We've seen that one-to-one control is impossible because there are too many control lines for the users. So in this video, we will see how to build decoders to turn on these units effectively. We need to break down the job of turning on a memory unit. It includes two things: choosing the right cell and choosing the right action. Users only need read and write control wires to indicate if they want to output or input. Internal wires can broadcast the message to each unit. But then, all the units will be turned on to either send or receive data. So we need an address line in front of each unit, confirming if it's the right one. Ending the read and write wire with the address line. Now, simply turning on the read or write wire isn't enough to turn on the memory unit. You also need to turn on the address line. So there are 256 address wires to turn on. But that doesn't mean users need that many control wires. The address wires can be reduced if you realize that the location consists of column and row position. So we lay column and row wires around the cells, with an AND gate checking if it's at the right column and right row. So now we only need 16 plus 16 control wires compared to the 256 before. Users pick the right cell by turning on the corresponding row and column wires. But now the question is, are we going to get users to turn on these column and row wires directly? If you have 4 GB memory, then you will end up with over 65,000 wires each way. So direct control is not feasible. If you realize that each control wire or each bit has two states, high or low, they can both be used to turn on things. Using an inverter, low voltage will turn on a wire. If it's high, connect it directly to the second wire. Now the second wire will be turned on. Add one more bit, we have two more states. We can control more wires. But if you connect the extra wires to only the extra bit, since either state can turn on a wire, now no matter how you flip the states, you will always have two wires on. So you need to turn off the duplicate. If you want to use a low first bit to turn on the first wire, you would also need to use it to shut down the duplicate through an AND gate. If you want to use a high first bit to turn on the second wire, you have to use the invert to turn off the duplicate. So using both bits to control the last two wires prevents them from becoming the duplicate, because the extra wiring means a more restricting way to turn them on. But these cannot prevent others from being the duplicate. Since the first two are controlled by only one bit, if we want to turn on the third wire, the second is a duplicate. We need to use a low second bit to turn it off. If we want the fourth wire on, the first is a duplicate, so we need a low second bit to turn it off. Now all these wires need more specific ways to be turned on. For example, the fourth wire is connected to the first bit after the inverter and the second bit before the inverter, so it needs a high-low to turn on. So the wiring can tell us the voltage pattern that can be used to turn on the wire. Conversely, knowing the voltage combination, you will know how to do the wiring. If you want to use a low low to turn on the first wire, you should connect to both bits after the inverter. So physical wiring and voltage combination are two sides of the same coin. If all we want is to do the wiring to turn on the wire, then why am I discussing this voltage combination? That's because with few control bits, it's easy to do wiring directly, like we just did. But with one more bit, how many wires we can control? And the critical question is how to ensure the wiring is unique. With more control bits, it's hard to know what wirings have been used and what haven't been, because it's too messy to look at. But it's easier to analyze from the angle of the voltage combination. What makes sure only one wire will be turned on at a time? For example, how this wiring guarantees only the first wire will be turned on but not others? Take a closer look at the voltage pattern. They are all different from one another by at least one bit. Focus on that different bit. This bit ensures that, as it's picking one wire, it's excluding others. So as the control bits are picking the wire, they'll also turn it off and in duplicate. So as long as we use different voltage combinations to control these wires, we can be sure that only one wire will be turned on. So the number of wires can be controlled depends on the number of unique voltage combinations, and that depends on the number of control bits. With 3 bits, there are 8 different combinations. You can control 8 wires. But wiring isn't easy, since it's hard to see if there are any misses or repetitions. So the only way to produce a complete and non-repetitive wiring is through an orderly way. Starting with 1 bit, 2 states. Use low to turn on the first, high to turn on the second. So here we record the voltage pattern that can turn on those 2 wires. Add 1 more bit, 2 more states, control doubles, because we can copy the wiring of the first bit over, low and high. So these 2 groups would duplicate each other. But that doesn't matter, since the second bit can be used to differentiate. Low to the first group, high to the second. Now 2 bits can control 4 wires. Add 1 more bit, control doubles again. So we need to use multi-input AND gates. Copy the previous wirings over. Connect the first group to low and second to high. Now 3 bits can control 8 wires. With 1 more bit, 2 more states, control doubles again. Now 4 bits can control 16 wires. Using voltage combination to control is super powerful. With 32 bits, you can control almost 4 billion memory cells. These wirings translating 4-bit voltage combinations to 16 choice lines is called a 4x16 decoder. So plugging decoders into the memory grid to control 16 row wires and 16 column wires. These voltage combinations are called memory addresses. This address needs to be stored in the memory unit, called memory address register, powering the decoders to select a unit. With decoders, instructions can also be condensed. For operation control, instead of 7 control bits, we only need 3. The 3 bits will go through a 3x8 decoders, selecting one of the operations. The extra output wire can be left unconnected. To select these 4 middle memory units, we can use the 2x4 decoders. So only 2 bits are needed to pick one unit. So decoders help to simplify the controls. But now to turn on the memory unit, we need to have its address first. This has impacts on the instruction structure, which we will talk about in the next video. You will see why these middle memory units are necessary.